As you can see today, we're looking at a Super 138 in one for the Neo Geo NVS. This is supposed to come with a subboard. This connects to your jammer connector on your NVS. It's a pass through, and it's important to note this because the way this works, I think it outputs video, it overlays video on some of the outputs here, and it also monitors the control input from this end of the jammer. It may well do it at this end as well, but I suspect it's probably just this end of the jammer. So if you've got a customised, a consolised NVS like I have, you just plug this in, you're not going to see anything because the video is not output on this side, it's output on this side as far as I understand. And the way this works is that this, it says there, menu card, this is kind of like a system in its own right really, and it's doing no more than, this is speculation on my part from just what I've seen, the pin, looking at the pinouts of some of these things and how, the fact that it won't work on a consolized NVS. And I know that's the case because I've got a friend who actually pointed me in the direction of this 138-in-1 and he's found the same thing with his. And it kind of makes sense really. And that's that. This works. This whole arrangement here with the subboard works differently to some of the other multicarts, or all of the other multicarts, in fact. And that is when you boot, say, a 161-in-1 on here, you'll have the default menu as the initial sort of P1 code, which allows you to select the game, and then it does some address decode, it alters the address decode in there to swap to some of the different ROMs and things, and then does a reset. And that's the way it works. And each of the games have been previously modified on those other carts so that you've got the hold down start for so many seconds to get back to the menu. I suspect that's the case anyway. That's why the CRCs are always different. But on this one, like I say, this is almost like a system in its own right. It's powered separately, it's powered off the NVS, off the jammer edge there, and then it overlays its own video on the screen. It seems to hold the NVS in a sort of inconsistent state. If you actually to look at the video signal coming out from the NVS, you just get blocks and things on the screen, and this provides the menu, so, and then it monitors the input from the control pad, so as you move up and down and hits the buttons and things to select the game, this then passes via the connector here, which I think is 8, well there's 10 connections. You've got power and ground on one of the either side of that connector there, kind of which one's which. And then the 8 connections in between are just used to identify the game that you've selected. So you've got 8 bits of a data line effectively that goes from between here and connects via this cable to the cart, and then it invokes a reset. And I guess this switch here is a reset. I'm not sure. You can use these switches here to configure it. I don't know. I think you can hide various games and things, and it's probably stored on a flash ROM or something on here. Just looking at that, looks like a Philips chip or something. I don't know. Looks like it. Yeah, that's an Altera Max. Very interesting. But yeah, that's it really in a nutshell. I think you've got a voltage regulator or two there. I'm not sure we've got two. Maybe there's some 1.8 volt logic or something going on there somewhere. One of those perhaps is 1.8, one's a 3.3 or something. No idea, not checked that. But yeah, anyway, that's it in a nutshell. So one thing you can do, and I have to apologise for the crudity, as you can see, I've got this little resistor array here with and I've got a couple sort of rogue resistors there, and a resistor sort of sat underneath, just because I wasn't sure the best way to approach it to start with. So this is a bit of a prototype. I'll probably just replace those resistors with one resistor pack or something. Need to get one ordered. But as you can see, that's it in a nutshell. You can just have a dip switch on there, and set these according to the game that you want. This has been done before. This is not me that's discovered this. It's well known. I think one or two people posted on the Neo Geo forums about this in the past. But what's interesting is following their colour coding of the lines here, these data lines, it doesn't match with the dip switch settings at all. Now these can be inverted. One thing you might notice is from the standard, if you bought a 138-in-1, in fact I think one of my friends is probably going to be watching this, he'll certainly notice this, I've swapped the black and the red around there, just because at one point I thought that the dip switches were inverted and I swapped the logic around, so instead of having a pull up I'm using a pull down, and actually I think I might need to swap that back the other way because it's the opposite is true. No, maybe it's right actually, I might have it right. I think I probably got my resistor pack on the wrong side of the thing basically, so the way I've inverted that, I think it needs to be like that at the moment in order to get, in the example here, I think we've got two, number two is on, seven's on and eight's on, all the rest are off. Could be wrong. I might have it written inverted. I honestly can't remember. But anyway, the dip switch settings are completely different than the two published lists from before. So, for example, it's some of them are the same, but not all of them. So I'm going to give you an example. Trying to find it now. R2Find 2's on here. And if I set the settings for that, it works. And what's the other one? Ninja Masters. If I set the settings for that game, it works. But if I try finding R2Find 3, I can't find it. The settings are not the same at all. And one or two of the other games, you know, and I know that it's not just the order of these data lines that's the issue. But some of the codes are completely different. I think there were three or four games I found that where they look at the number of bits that are set or not set and they do not correspond, even if you invert them and even if you mix them up, there's a totally different number of bits set, if you like, on these dip switches than there are on the original list that was published on the Neo Geo forum. So I need to take this apart now anyway, and this is going to be it's kind of a teardown, I guess. I'll just show you the insides of this while we're here. And I just want to have a look at what order these wires land on the board, because you know, that's going to be part of the whole solution here. I want to see where they go and see if it can work make some sense of the order of these dip switches, because I want to find, you know, which is the lowest, least significant bit, which is the most significant bit if I can. And there might be some clue in here, so we'll just get these four screws out now and carefully take the boards out. So I've got the top board out here, and you can see we've got another Altera Max FPGA / CPLD. A couple of diodes to drop the voltage again, room for a voltage regulator, so that's something I might do at some point. You can see tons of flux all over the bloody place on this. They don't clean these up. Not sure if they've used new chips on this. Looks like they possibly have done, because they've not got labels and things on there. It's only components on one side of the board here. There's nothing on this side other than your ribbon to connect your two boards together. In fact, that one there, that's the one that connects the two boards together. There's a bit of glue or something on there, I don't know what that is. And then you want to connect to your external board, your third board. So I'll clean the contacts up while I'm here, but I needed to do this anyway because it wasn't making a very good connection, this, and I think I know why. I don't think the board's completely straight, and if you look at this, I don't know how well it's going to you're going to see this. Can you do this point down here? The plastic is snagging on the PCB, and I cannot get this board out at all. I've put a lot of force trying to get it out. It will not come out. It must have been forced into there. You know, the PCB is a hole is smaller than the protruding bits of plastic. So I'm going to have to very carefully, you know, try and shave the edge of that just a little bit or something, and try and leave the damn thing out. So we can have a look at that bottom board, but I'm pretty sure that's why it's not making a good connection. And I think while I'm here, I'm just going to file a tiny bit off the edges of these as well. And it's not sticking like the 161-in-1 did, but I'll do that anyway and just go over these with an eraser and some isopropyl. So there we go, that's the bottom board out, and that was a pain in the arse, it really was. Well, I'll show you what I ended up having to do, if I can. I don't want to crease my label here, that's just, bear with me a sec. Yeah, this support here, as it was with the PCB stuck through it, I had to very carefully slice, just like, I don't know, a quarter of a millimetre off, all the way from the top of it, all the way down to where it met the board, because it was almost wider than the actual hole was here. As soon as I did that, it came straight off with ease, and I haven't damaged the board, and you can see that, there's just a tiny mark at the top of the plastic edge there, but I've not touched the tracks or anything. And as you can see, very much like the other board, mucky mess of flux and stuff. The chips are pretty well aligned and things on these, so if they cleaned it up, it wouldn't be too bad actually. This 138-in-1, it's just a load of flux really. General condition is pretty good really, apart from the flux. Yeah, there's not much else to say about this one. You've seen this board before anyway. I think this is the same as, I can't remember. I think it's the same as the 120-in-1 or something. If you look at that board, you'll see there's a board that says TA138-in-1. So this is not, there's nothing new about this really, other than on the top, you know, on the program board, having that cable coming off, going to the additional PCB there. So yeah, nothing exciting at all. And I guess while we're here, Miz will show you. You'll have seen this briefly a few minutes back, but the you know, the connectivity here, so you can see the order. So on my board here, I've got from the top, we've got red, green, brown, orange, yellow, white, blue, grey, black, and your red and your black are your plus five and your ground, respectively, I think. So if I look at the dip switch settings, yeah, on the other side, we've got, and I'll just see if these correspond. You should be able to hopefully see if these correspond. I've got green, then brown, then orange, then yellow, then white, then blue, then purple, and then grey. Yeah, so they're in the same order that they are on there. Hopefully, if you're going to do this mod yourself and you follow my example here, you'll have the same arrangement there with the same colours in the same order. But anyway, I'll clean this up now, reassemble it, and we'll have a look at the car itself and on the MBS. So apologies, it's just started raining in here at the moment. As you can see, you've got the dip switch board working on there. It's a bit of a mess. I've got this ad hoc resistor network there. I've ordered a proper resistor array for that, so I'll swap that out and I'll file the end of that board down. And it'll look a bit tidier. I'm going to leave it like that. It's actually, it works, it's fine, it's no issues at all. That wasn't the case from the start. I had major problems with this where I couldn't work it. In fact, some of the games, I would say about only a quarter, perhaps half of most of the games were available to me. And it was proving a nightmare trying to find the right dip switch settings. It didn't correspond to the two published lists on the Geo forum thread. And what the end result really is that the colour of these wires, if you follow that guide, it suggests that the red is the plus five and the white is the VCC. That's not the case at all. They could be any. The wires could be any colours and any orientation, so you can't rely on that guide in that sense, really. What I ended up having to do, and it took me a while to work it out, but after I came to the conclusion that I had a bit, certainly one bit missing, which is why I could only get half the number of games, I went back to the PCB here where I moved the socket and I did some continuity tests, something I should have done from the start. You know, never take guides as read, really, because different board revisions could be made and all sorts of things. So it's my own fault, really, but a friend of mine ran into exactly the same problem, and that convinced me that, you know, say we were missing a bit. And there's 10 connections on here. The first one, I think it's the first one, yeah, it will be, the first one there, connects to ground, which I think is those top two on the jammer. I think it's the opposite two on the other side, that side there as well. So that's definitely ground. And then I start to think, well, okay, where's the VCC? And as you test, there's a couple of voltage regulators here, as I pointed out earlier on. It's worth pointing out the you've not got the typical pinout on these where you'd have in, ground, out. It's actually in, out, ground on these, this particular way around, and that's also at the out tab. So you've got, I did some connection checks here, and again you've got plus five coming into each of these regulators. That's a 1.8 volt regulator, and I did, if you look, you probably want to see if there's a little test pad there that says 1.8, so I was right about that. That's a 1.8 volt regulator, and that's a 3.3 volt regulator. So anyway, the center tabs on these, the center pins and the actual tabs at the bottom, those are the outputs, and I did continuity all the way down and there is no continuity. So power from this board is not supplied to any of these pins, which is interesting. Now what you do get, if I flip it over, again I did continuity, you know, we've done the ground, we know where the ground is, so continuing on with the other nine, that first one ends up being one of the pins on this chip here, which is, I think it's a 74244, so it's like, you know, a tri-state latch or something, you know, it's just used to isolate, you know, at various points in time so that you can switch it on and enable output and disable it and stop output. I'm pretty sure that's what that's for. It's just like a driver, effectively just drive it at a buffer, just a buffer. So that, like I said, the second pin goes to that one pin, one gate on that chip, and then all of the other remaining eight, go to gates on that chip there. And I thought, it's a bit odd, you've only got one coming to here. So then what I did is I powered it up without this PCB on, and I measured the voltages. We knew where the ground is, that's a given, we know what that is. I measured the voltages on each of the other nine pins, and as soon as it came to the second pin, right from the start there, it's like 4.25 volts or 4.5 volts. It's not 5 volts, it's above 4, but it's not 5, and it's actually well below 5, so I thought, well, that's a bit odd. And on every single one of the other pins there, you got 2.5 volts, and I thought, ah, we've got some pull-ups on the data lines. So the data lines are pins 3 through 10, and that pin 2 was a mysterious, like say, 4.25, 4.5 volts. I thought that must be the VCC effectively, and for whatever reason it's been backfed into one of the gates on here. I guess this has been read as an input Could be wrong. It just could be a fudge the way the whole thing works. But I'm just wondering if that's reading it's reading that as an input on this chip. So perhaps once the game's been set, the addresses have been set on here, so it's not non-zero, and the reset's been invoked, it latches and then it puts a high. The FPGA on the car is actually putting a high back. Well, it's using that 4.25 volts or 4.5 volts to backfeed this, so that it disables the on-screen display on here. I guess, I could be wrong, but I think that's probably what's happening, or something very similar. It could just be that there's 4.25 or 4.5 volts on that second pin all the time on here from the cart itself, regardless. I don't know, but in any case, that's exactly, you know, you need a voltage there to, in order to, you know, provide the high for the various inputs with these dip switches. So the way these dip switches working at the moment, you've got that the second pin is bringing you 4.25. I keep saying those two values because I can't, but it's somewhere in between those. It might be 4.4 or 4.35 or something volts anyway. So it's providing those that voltage through the resistor network to each of the data lines, each of the eight data lines there. That's the way that's wired. So as that stands, without the dip switch settings on there, they're all just high. It's making them all high. And then what this dip switch bank's doing, they're all connected to the same points, you know, the same data lines again, at the point where the resistor powers the each of the cables, you know, that connection there, not the side with the VCC, but the side that goes to the address lines. One pin on each of those dip switches is, you know, connected to one pin of each of the data or address lines. I keep calling them data or address lines. You could see them as either way, really. Yes, they are an address, but they're also data. It depends, you know, they're just you know, data lines, address lines, call them what you want. There's two ways of looking at that. It's a bus, effectively, of one kind or the other. But anyway, so what these do is they pull the point there, the connection to the address pin, to ground, using the ground from the first pin there. So it's dead straightforward. That's the way mine's working anyway. And as a result, actually, these dip switches are inverted. If I was to look at these, the numbers on here and go, you know, 0, 1, 1, whatever, you know, however many ones there are, I've got to put the opposite way around on here. My ones are actually designated by the off position rather than the on position, just because of the way that I've done that. But it's working, so I'm not going to change it. I might change it when the resistor array comes for this. You know, I don't want to tidy that up, but it's working for the moment, and that's all there is to it, really. And this table of the games here with the dip switch settings, this works. Every single one of these is spot on. So I'm pleased with that. Just give you a quick look at the thing working now. But yeah, that's all done. So as you can see, got it working here. This is Sengoku 2. Let's just start that. Most of the games seem okay. One or two of mine have got sound glitches. I've actually ordered another one of these carts, just to see if I can get those particular games, you know, without the sound, because those are games that I've cared about, really. Sweet. I'll just show you some of the dip switches now, and we'll just change it to another game. So it's set to Sengoku 2 at the moment, which is that one. So we've got number 2 up, miss 3, 4 and 5, so 2, 4 and 5. And as I show you on here, this is inverted, the logic is inverted. You could swap it around. I could change this so that the plus 5, sorry, it's not focusing very well, that the plus 5 and the ground are the opposite way around. But as you can see, we've got 2, 4 and 5, so I'll switch that off. So I caused a glitch there by handling the dip switch, which you can do if you put your finger contacts underneath there whilst it's working. You can interfere with the game, so that's worth pointing out, I think. So what should we load? Let's load Art of Fighting 3. So Art of Fighting 3, sorry, off camera as usual. I've got 3 and 4 down. Oh yeah, I missed one. Damn. Well, you can see that number 7, so try again. Just bring number 7 down. There we go, try again. So yeah, it's a bit of a pain in some sense, but how often do you change games, really? You know, I'm just going to be, there you go, Art of Fighting 3. Swapping between two or three games I use on this, Art of Fighting 3 being one of them. This is a sweet game. Sprites are massive. Love it. round one. Excellent. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.